just as an archaeologist uncovers secrets of the past, a tape recorder archaeologist or a vintage technologies archaeologist discovers secrets of the past as well. It's just the most recent past that we're dealing with. And our Christmas tape recorder has a serious secret to reveal. Now, we're looking at the secret right now. Can you figure out what is the secret, besides the fact that this is a microphone? Stay tuned to the video and find out the secret of the Christmas tape recorder. In their Christmas catalog for 1961, the American electronics vendor Radio Shack offered a unique tape recorder under its house brand name, Realistic. The machine was unique to the vendor because it was made by Robuk Electrical Industries of London, England. The two-track high-fidelity monophonic tape recorder featured a three-motor transport with three speeds, sound-on-sound, and sound-with-sound capability, housed in a stylish two-tone fabric-covered wood case. Radio Shack labeled it Realistic by Robuk, and it sold for a limited time. By 1963, it was gone. 54 years later, in 2016, a Realistic by Robuk tape recorder appeared on eBay. Recognizing the unique rarity and audiophile value of the machine, ClydeSight purchased it for historical preservation. Welcome to the Christmas Tape Recorder. This video series is a documentary of the arrival, exploration, and restoration of this rarely seen or heard, unique, consumer-grade tape recorder. The Realistic Robuk tape recorder microphone is all ready to go. It's working, which we'll see later in the video how I managed to demonstrate that, even though the tape recorder itself is not working. And I just wanted to show you how this thing was constructed, because it's kind of interesting. We see here the cartridge for the microphone. At first I thought this was a crystal microphone. The machine is a tube type amplifier, and many of the tape recorders that I've worked on use a crystal microphone when they have a tube-type amplifier. Also, the appearance of this cartridge reminded me very much of a Webcore cartridge that I have on a model B210, and that is definitely a crystal cartridge. So that's why I thought it was a crystal cartridge. But when I tested it, it does not have the sound of a crystal cartridge. It has the sound of a dynamic cartridge. Unfortunately, because I don't have enough documentation on it, I don't know what was originally spec'd for this, but I'm thinking it probably was dynamic. Anyway, the cartridge, it looks kind of ratty, but that's just discoloration of the metal caused by the foam that was inside the microphone that deteriorated and turned to dust. We're lucky there was a screen here so it didn't get into the actual workings of the cartridge. Here is the screen cloth material that we saw on the speaker, but this is in very good shape. It's not dirty or anything. And I've cleaned the whole thing, and it's all ready to go. Wanted to show you the construction. Notice these four holes here, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And those are for these posts that you see here. And you see each of the posts has a little metal, it's like a clip. This one, the metal clip is actually inside the hole. But this lets you press fit this together, so they're not gluing it together. Some of the microphones I've seen from the early 60s were glued together so you couldn't work on them. And some of them have been defective, so they have to be replaced, but that's not the way this works. So a new cartridge could have been inserted here at the time if necessary, if anything happened to it. There also is no strain relief on the cord. That's why it's pinched through here, because it passes through this handle that is going around the outside, and that is actually, you see it swings, that's actually the stand, and I'll show you how that works in a minute. So all I need to do is put this back together, and you'll see how it goes together, and you'll see how it looks now that it's been restored. and that's all there is to it. It just presses together. Now, you see, here's the handle that I was talking about, and now we can stand it up. Isn't that fun? If you looked at the previous video, episode 3, at the very end I showed the beginnings of what I was doing with this microphone, and this edge along here and here in the back, this edge, this one in the back, all had burn marks from the cable being wrapped around it like this. Not a good idea. So I used a rotary tool and buffed it all out and then polished it, and it came out pretty well. I'm kind of pleased with that. Also notice that there's a grill cloth on the back, but there's nothing really here that would let sound go into the cartridge. I'm not sure why they put the grill cloth there, except maybe just to make it look like it was fancy, or who knows. And of course there is this yellow mark here that I can't get out. I'm not sure what caused that. But we do see the realistic badge here, and you can just see it's nicely restored. At least I think so. So, what is the great secret that this microphone has revealed? This is the plug end of the microphone. I'm bringing it up real close. It looks like a standard RCA male connector. However, notice this pin. This pin is too long. Here is a modern RCA connector, and here is this one. Notice what happens? They should be butting right up against the shields, both of them. And the reason they did this was because of the jacks that are in the tape recorder. They're cutoff jacks. They do two jobs. Just like a mini jack or a quarter inch jack can be used to cut off a speaker when you plug it in or to make multiple connections, that's why they designed this to do that. I believe that this type of jack is called a long reach pin plug. And if you Google long reach RCA pin plug, you're going to find just a few comments about it in audio forms, but you're not going to find any of these available. Now the structure is interesting. It doesn't have a standard plastic shield. It has this, which is really weird. And of course it's very hard for the camera to stay in focus on this, but you see here, there's a hole, and if you look in here, you can't see it really, but there's a bump. And the bump locks into the hole. If I do it right, there we go. And you see how it becomes an insulator. And the ground shield is soldered just to the shell, and of course this is the rest of the shield. And then the other piece of plastic goes here. And you see how that makes that a collar. And then this metal piece slides over the shield and over the plastic. I'm not going to do it now. Because it's hard to do and you need some pliers and tools, but you can see how it will slide onto it. And I have to spread this open because this has a split. It's like a split ring type of thing, so you have to fuss with screwdrivers and things to do that. With that long reach of the pin, if you put it into a normal socket, it doesn't go any further than that. It bottoms out so that the shield doesn't contact this shield. This makes this microphone completely useless in any other tape recorder, and it makes any other tape recorder microphone useless in this tape recorder, because this isn't long enough to disconnect the connections that are in the tape recorder. And we'll look at those connections later on when we work with the tape recorder. It's not a problem for me because I have the microphone, but it's going to be a problem for me if I want to do full testing, because the speaker, the loudspeaker RCA jack, uses this same type of plug. And you can't get these for love nor money because they just ain't around. There was one place in England that was carrying them, and they're listing it on their website as out of stock. And it's out of stock because they don't make it anymore. I have one idea that I can work with, and that is I can take this, cut the cable here or further along the line, however I want to do it, put in a standard RCA socket here and a standard RCA plug here. And that way I can disconnect this from the microphone and then could use it with a loudspeaker that has a standard RCA component on it. I don't see the need to do that right now. When I'm testing the tape recorder, I may decide to do that, but there's no need to rush to do that right now. Let me put this back together, and I will show you what it looks like all assembled, and then I'll show you the test, because I actually got it to work with a Sony tape recorder. It's time for the test to hear what does this microphone sound like. Now, we can't hear it on the Robuk tape recorder yet, but we can hear it on this beautiful Sony TC-106 tape recorder. So we're going to hear a comparison test. First, we're going to hear the Robuk tape recorder microphone. Then we're going to hear a cheap crystal microphone, which was proof that the Robuk is not a crystal microphone. You'll hear the difference. Then a basic generic dynamic microphone. This is a Radio Shack microphone for cassette recorders from the late 60s. And finally, a Sony cardioid dynamic microphone, the F98. So we will hear the complete range of microphones and find out where does this sound among them. And I think you're going to find an interesting result. So let's, without further ado, get the tape recorder going. Here we go. This is a test of the Realistic by Robuk microphone. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is a test of a cheap crystal microphone. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is a test of a universal replacement dynamic microphone for cassette recorders. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is a test of the Sony cardioid dynamic microphone, number F98. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So there you have it. And I think that this general purpose dynamic microphone from Radio Shack is closest to the sound of the Realistic by Robuk tape recorder microphone, at least on the Sony. This is a test of the Realistic by Robuk microphone. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. This is a test of a universal replacement dynamic microphone for cassette recorders. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now, what it's going to sound like on the Robuk tape recorder, the Realistic by Robuk tape recorder, that remains to be seen for when the tape recorder gets restored. Thanks for watching this special episode of the Christmas tape recorder, the secrets of the Christmas tape recorder, and for learning about how this microphone worked. This issue with this plug is a very serious one, because if I had not tested this outside of the tape recorder, it may have taken me months to figure out why a regular microphone would not work with this machine, and why a regular loudspeaker would not work when plugged into the jack for the loudspeaker. Thanks for watching the video. Please give us a thumbs up and leave a comment, especially you folks from the UK. This plug and its mating jack were unique to English tape recorders and equipment. I'd love to hear from you guys anything that you know about this special long reach RCA plug and jack.